Thank you. Thank you so much. And good afternoon, almost good evening. And I'm keenly aware that the bar is about to open. So I promise you this will be focused and on time. So how cool and what a privilege to be on this stage. As Aaron said, I've always, literally, always wanted to be a rock star. And I've actually played in bands my entire adult life. And as you can tell, that didn't get me to this stage. So I had to do the CEO thing to get on this stage. So it's really a privilege to do this. And I can't wait to tell my three sons, who all play in bands themselves, that I got to perform on the Austin City Limits stage. So what a great privilege to be here with you tonight. I want to share a little bit about the NiSource story and our particular journey, which I think is a bit unique to this transition away from coal. And it's a really interesting time in our industry, in our business, and in our particular area. So first, a little bit about who NiSource is. Just in case you don't know us, we're 8,000 people, 8,000 employees, working together every day to serve our 4 million customers. And we collectively, and I personally view that as a great privilege, the opportunity to do this work that we do. I've done this my entire life, 33 years now in the industry, to do this work that we do and that really all of us do, whether you're in the regulatory space, a technology, a provider to the industry, work in any of the fields that are represented here, I think you'll join me in recognizing what a great privilege it is to do what we do in such a dynamic and exciting time. NiSource operates across 7 states, from Indiana to Massachusetts and down to Virginia, so predominantly Midwest, a local gas distribution utilities in all 7 states, serving the vast majority of our customers, and our one electric utility in Northwest Indiana goes by the brand name of NIPSCO, Northern Indiana Public Service Company, serves about 500,000 customers, and that's where this gets interesting. While you might think of that as a by sort of the scale of some of the electric utilities in the industry, that's a relatively small electric utility, although we operate across the entire value chain, vertically integrated electric generation, transmission, distribution, again serving 500,000 customers. But what's really unique about our profile, 40% of our sales go to 5 customers, 5 large industrial energy intense customers. And that defines a lot about how we think about not just our customer base, but the economy that we serve, the region that we serve. Think steel, petrochemical, very traditional energy-intense industries. And so this theme of love your energy, for me and for us, really transforms into love your customer. And I think you can hear that throughout a lot of the discussions today, this convergence of customer intimacy or customer relationships where we truly understand our customers' needs. That's front and center for us in a pretty significant way, especially as we make these long-term decisions about the future of the supply portfolio in particular and the future of our business and how we place those bets, if you want to think about it that way. All starts with our customers. So dynamic and exciting times. For us, like for so many of the electric utilities and gas utilities across the industry, it starts with reliability and affordability. That customer value defined very, very convincingly around affordability, reliability, environmental impact, increasingly power quality as it relates to the value proposition for our customers. And we take all of that into effect. So our economics at NIPSCO, at NiSource, drive our customers' economics. This is front and center, and drive our planning, and drive all of the decision-making. And that's where I want to start the story for how we began this transition away from coal and how it came together. NIPSCO is about a 3-gigawatt production portfolio, and we operate, again, in Indiana, and we're a member of MISO. So MISO is about 100 gigawatt RTO. So we're 3 gigawatts inside a 100 gigawatt marketplace. And we're making, as we plan the transition for our generating portfolio, 30-year decisions, 20 to 30-year decisions in what we all know is a pretty volatile political and policy cycle, 2 to 4-year policy environment. and maybe a 3-year market window. So we're making very long bets, very long decisions in an environment that doesn't necessarily give you certainty or clarity around that future. And that's where this story starts for us. Today, that 3 gigawatts, our portfolio is 71% coal, about 25% natural gas, so it's a fossil fuel portfolio, and the remainder renewables. We have a couple of small hydros that are almost 100 years old on the Tippecanoe River, and we also have a wind PPA, about 100 megawatt PPA, that dates back about a decade now. So we've been in the wind, have brought wind into the portfolio for the past decade or so. Our coal supplies, while we're in the Midwest and coal is predominant in Indiana, Kentucky, Ohio, West Virginia, our coal all comes from the Powder River Basin, largely due to chemistry and logistics, the ability to source coal into Northwest Indiana from the Midwest is somewhat complicated, so rail from PRB is our predominant source. Our gas unit is near Terre Haute on the western edge of Indiana along Interstate 70. And our MISO participation gives us access to significant wind opportunities to the west of us. So we're at the eastern edge of MISO, the northeastern edge, and that gives us significant opportunities to source wind for our customers, and also, as many utilities do, to use MISO as an opportunity to sell surplus energy and capacity and flow those proceeds back to our customers. So it's a fair value proposition to our customers. The landscape has changed significantly. In the last couple of years, the landscape for the kind of planning we're talking about, planning retirement, retrofit, or replacement of generating capacity has changed dramatically. And we use a very traditional approach, an integrated resource planning process that we do every couple years in Indiana. It's overseen by the regulatory commission. And we use that process to lay out the economics of supply decisions. In 2016, we did this, and we focused more on whether to retrofit existing coal units to comply with US EPA rules on coal ash handling and effluent water discharge, and whether to retrofit or retire. And a lot of analysis around that pointed at retirement. We were nearing the end of the economic life of those coal assets. And I won't go through what that particular IRP said in terms of the retirement sequencing, but it wasn't as fast as what we are now seeing in the IRP that we filed just last year. A little more of an orderly, staged process than we are now promoting and supporting. What we didn't focus as much on in 2016 was the replacement portfolio. So for coal that would retire, the leading candidates for replacement were natural gas combined cycle units, and that was done with rigorous modeling and understanding of what's available in the marketplace, but a self-build combined cycle plan was the replacement capacity. So we weren't really in a moment where we needed to execute any of those plans. 2023 is kind of the date on the calendar when we'd need to either retrofit or retire the coal units. So we fast forwarded to 2018, doing another IRP, an update, if you will, to that IRP. And when we got to 2018, now we're entering a zone where we've got to start to make decisions based on these analyses. It's time to think about if you're retiring assets for 2023, if you're going to build something, you've got to get started. So we said the real premium here for us in this process, and this goes back to love your customers, is to make sure that we build trust among all stakeholders, that all of our stakeholders understand how decisions are made, how the modeling is done, have input into that process. So we place a high premium on transparency and stakeholder engagement across all of our customers. And we did that about a year ago. We started into that process, but this time we did what I believe is a somewhat novel approach. We ran in parallel an RFP for supply, for new capacity delivered in 2023 from the marketplace, from an all of the above approach to capacity sourcing. So we could all see what's out there, what's gonna be the best fit for our particular set of needs in 2023. Those RFPs came in, 90 projects were bid in, really robust, well over 10,000 megawatts of capacity bid in for delivery in 2023 for about 1,300 megawatts of need. So really robust supply options. The big surprise, and I'll admit, I was surprised. What we saw was no surprise that coal is out of the money. We just because of the age of the assets that we're operating, we could see operating costs, maintenance costs going up. Some of our units will be almost 50 years old, some 55 years old when they're retired on the schedule that we're talking about. Now for me, that's personally a little bit troubling. I just turned 56 this past weekend. So I'm really watching my maintenance costs now, lest I be retired too quickly. But it's just clear we I don't think we should extrapolate this learning into other companies or other assets, but in our particular case, it's time for these assets to be retired on straightforward economics. Now, we analyze environmental impact, we analyze reliability, all of the other factors are a part of this, but this is core economics driving this. So the big surprise is natural gas wasn't the best solution. A complete renewables portfolio, transactable off of these RFPs into our zone in MISO, was by far the best solution for us. And that tells you that we're in a very unique moment. We're in a different day, in a different time than conventional wisdom would have said we were in just a few short years ago. And that's what's exciting about this. While for us, this has been a multi-factor, multi-consideration analysis, a way to look at all of the options available to us to make sure we meet the unique needs of our customer base, the very privilege that we're here to do is to serve those needs, to make sure we do that, to do that in the most economic way and the most environmentally beneficial way is a really wonderful thing to be in a position to do that. So the plan was set up. What it shows is over the life of the plan, a 20-year NPV, a $4 billion economic benefit to our customers to transition away from coal to renewables. We will be 65% renewable on the other side of this transition, 25% gas. Our gas unit's relatively new and in very good condition. And then the remainder, a combination of other factors, predominantly DSM in our marketplace. So an exciting time. We came out publicly with that proposal late last year, have since begun to execute on that. We filed with the commission a plan for 800 megawatts of wind projects to be delivered next year, kind of the front edge of this strategy, our opportunity to step in an orderly way through a transition to renewables from coal. And there's a backdrop to that too. One of the designs in our plan, or one of the key architectural elements of our plan, is that we want to preserve real options as we step through time. Because if we're seeing the market changing this rapidly in the last few years, who knows what the next 5, 10, 15 years provide. So if we can sequence this in a way where we'll retire a big portion of our capacity, about 80% by 2023, and the remainder in 2028, that gives us multiple opportunities to run more RFPs, to scan the market, to make sure we're looking at solar and storage, which came in strong in the RFP last year. We're going after wind now, but in all likelihood, we'll have a significant amount of solar and solar plus storage in the mix as we go forward. So I think it's a little bit of a different story because this is an all of the above in terms of the factors that are considered, driven by economics and reliability front and center, as has always been the case for utilities, and environmental benefits and delivering that full package in a very, I think, compelling way. The other side of this, in the part that I think, and I'm getting the red light, but I'm gonna wrap up on a couple of quick points here. The other side of this is the grid itself, the opportunities, and there's a lot of that discussion inside the panels here and a number of the speakers. The transformation of the grid is an exciting and dynamic opportunity as well. To move toward a distributed supply portfolio, significant renewables penetration, means the grid has to operate in a fundamentally different way. And I started my career as a transmission and distribution planning engineer 30-some years ago and did the models that looked at, if you lose this section of line and that section of line, can you still keep the power flowing in a particular region? And so that kind of analysis is front and center again to make sure that we have the resiliency and the supply reliability that's essential for our customers. And then as I think back, I'll wrap up with a story here. 30-some years ago, as a brand new, fresh college grad electrical engineer working in my hometown in the Ohio Valley, so think Ohio River Valley, dotted with the very kinds of industrial steel mills that we're talking about in our Northwest Indiana territory, and coal plants up and down the river. I used to go out and give speeches to the Kiwanis Club, the Rotary, any number of public groups. And I remember this vividly. The title of one of the presentations was Coal by Wire, because we thought it was such an innovative thing that you could generate a large amount of electricity from a large central station coal plant and transmit it by wire to a load center that could be hundreds of miles away. And people were fascinated by that. What I find fascinating is, reflecting on that, we weren't talking at all about any other options. In that moment in time, we really didn't imagine that there could be a day like today where that no longer makes sense, and we're seeing the kind of transformation that's underway across the country. I find that quite exciting. I find that to be just what's so exciting about the moment that we're in and the 30 years that are ahead of us and what lies ahead, how exciting that can be for the people that come behind us to help engineer that transition. So I appreciate the opportunity to share the NiSource story with you. I won't stand between you and the bar. If I had my accordion, I'd invite you back in for a little bit of music, but I forgot to bring it. So thank you very much. Have a great evening.